Okay, welcome to chemistry, and today we're going to look at separation techniques, but in this case we're going to look at chromatography. In the previous lesson we looked at separating funnel, simple distillation and fraction distillation. In this case we're going to look at chromatography. So chromatography is a method which uses a solvent to separate mixtures. So a method or a technique that uses a solvent to separate mixtures. Now this solvent that we're talking about here can use water, we can use ethanol, or we can use propanol. So these are the solvents that can be used to separate mixtures. So the method which uses a solvent to separate mixtures is called chromatography. And the results that you obtain after you do this experiment, they will be what we call a chromatogram. So a chromatogram is a paper that contains the results. So these are results of chromatography. So the experiment is chromatography, then the results that you obtain, they will be on a chromatogram. And since we have said we are going to use a solvent to separate these mixtures, that solvent that you can use is either water, ethanol and propanol. Now what makes it possible for chromatograph to be taken? Or how do you cut out chromatograph, or how do the mixtures separate? So the mixtures separate because of difference in air solubility, difference in thickness to the porous material, C, the density. So these mixtures, they are able to separate because they have got different solubility. Remember, we are using a solvent, difference in the thickness to the porous material, in this case, which is a filter paper, and also the density of these substances. That's how these mixtures are able to separate. So chromatography is very, very important because it is used in so many things. So what do you use chromatography for? One, we can use chromatography to identify a pure substance. So we use chromatography to identify a pure substance. We use chromatography to identify poisonous substances or drugs. Again, we use chromatography to identify or separate the dyes in ink. We also use chromatography to separate amino acids, to separate and identify amino acids. We can also use chromatography to separate pigments in plants. So all these are important uses of chromatograph. So the government, if there's a substance that is not allowed in the street, the government can use chromatograph to identify that substance and what components it has. Now, how do you cut out this experiment on chromatograph? So this is what we're going to do. So now the method which we are going to use. So this, let me say, procedure. So chromatography can be done in two ways. We use a filter paper. Now a filter paper can have a filter paper. So this is the first method. So we can have, so this is the filter paper. And now if you want to separate, let's say an example, we are trying to separate the dyes in ink. Or we want to know, what are the dyes that are found in ink, or what are the colors that are found in ink? So we can use this simple method. We'll get a filter paper, then you get the ink sample, you place it on the middle. Okay. Then, so this is the sample of ink. So sample of ink on the middle, then you add drops. So the next thing you do, you add the drops of the solvent. So you add drop the solvent on the same spot where the sample of ink is placed. After you add this, you give it some time, let's say 15 minutes. So after 15 minutes, we're going to have the results. So this, we still have our filter paper. So we're going to have our ink, which we had placed. Then we're going to have something that will be looking like rings. Okay, so after you add the solvent there, these will be our results that are going to be obtained. So I've got two rings. So I've got the first ring here and the second ring. So we're using chromatograph to know what kind of dyes are found in ink, and we're able to see that there are two that are found in the ink that we have used. So I've got this one and about this one. So all these we are separating because the two, they are soluble in the solvent that we have used. So they are soluble in the solvent that we have used. So the one that has moved the furthest, like this one, it is the most soluble compared to this one. Okay. So this is the simple method that we can use also to check him, to do the a simple chromatograph process. Then the other one which you can use, the second method that you can use, instead of having a filter paper in this form, you can have a filter paper in this form. Now, in this case, you draw a line. This line must be drawn using a pencil because a pencil is made up of a pure substance, which is graphite, and graphite is carbon. We cannot use a pen because the pen is not pure. We have seen that it contains other substances. So if you put a pen here, it means even the pen will separate into its components. The dyes in a pen will separate into its components. Okay, so we draw this line using a pencil, and this line is called the start line, or some books will say the baseline. Okay. So in this example, we're trying to know what substances are found in a mixer X. So let's say mixer X. So in mixer X, we don't know what it contains. So we have got pure substances like A, B, C, D, and E. So we have got a mixer X, and I've got five pure substances, A, B, C, D, and E. And we want to know, among these ones, which one is found in E mixer X. So we're trying to identify what mixer X contains, and we're using E chromatograph. So what we do is, we place mixer X, a sample of mixer X, or a drop of X on the line that we have drawn using a pencil. Then we also place these pure substances, like A, B, C, D, and E. All these are placed on the filter paper. So this is the filter paper. Okay, so these are placed on the start line. Then this filter paper, after placing the samples, it is made into the form of a cylindrical shape. So we are making it like this, like a shape. Remember that the outside part where the lines, where the start line is, must be outside of the paper. Then you place it into what we call a chromatogram tank. Or if you don't have this tank, you can just use a beaker. So in this beaker, you add a solvent. So we're adding a solvent. Then you place this. So this is our paper. Remember, it's in form of a cylinder. And this line, we make sure that it's above the solvent level. So this is our start line, which contains, remember, our samples. Then this, you cover it. So this is a cover. Why do we cover it? We don't want the solvent to start evaporating. There are solvents like ethane that may start evaporating, so we want to avoid that. Okay, and this is our filter paper, which is our porous material. Okay, so we get this, we fold it form of cylinder, we add it in here. So remember that we said this start line must be above the solvent. So this is a solvent line. This, the start line or the baseline, must be above the solvent. So the idea is so that these samples you have added, they don't dissolve in the solvent, but you want them to move with the solvent. So this solvent will be moving on the paper. As we see, when you add water on the paper, the water will start moving on the paper. So that's what's happening here. That's the same thing that happened here. After adding the sample, the solvent here, it starts moving. And as they're moving, they're separating. So even here, the moment you just add this to the solvent will start moving up the paper. As it is moving up the paper, it's moving with all the samples, as long as that sample is soluble in that solvent that you have used. Now, after do this, before this solvent reaches the end part of the paper, you have to remove the filter paper from the chromatogram tank. So this one, you can either use a beaker in the lab if you don't have the tank. So after this, now we get the paper. So we get this paper. Now, because it was inside this this beaker and it is wet, you can dry it. Now, how can you dry it? So in chemistry, you can dry using a lot of things. But the simple way of drying this paper, you can just use the ammonia gas. You open a bottle of ammonia, you get this, you dry it there, the paper will definitely dry. So I've got our samples X and our samples. Now, after removing this, we expect all these samples to move. So let's say after removing it, we expect we have the samples have moved like this. After doing the chromatography, these are the results. Now, this is called a chromatogram because it contains our results. So sometimes these substances, if they're not colored, it's very difficult for you to see them. So how can you make them visible? By using what we call a locating agent. So we use a locating agent, and this is called ninhydrin. That's the one that we can use. You just spray it. It's an organic compound which will make this supposed to be more visible. Okay. So after the results have come out, we have got a chromatogram here. We want to know now, what does X contain? So X, we're trying to interpret the results now. X contains, so the only thing that you do is you just check which ones have moved the same height with the substance that is found in X. So let's look at A. So A has moved up to here and it's in the same line with this substance, this one, for X. So X contains A. We come to B. B has moved up to here, but there's nothing here, so B is not found in X. Let's look at C. So the C has moved the same distance with this one, so C is found in X. Let's look at D. So D has not moved, it has just been here, so D has not moved. Let's look at E. So E has moved, so it's also found in X. We just compare the distance that these have moved. So this and this are the same. This and this are the same. For B, they're not the same because it does not correspond with anything that is found in X. For D, it has not moved, still maintained there. So I've got this. So we can say that X contains A, B, and C. But we've got this substance here. This substance from X, it is not contained in any of these, meaning that another one is a known substance, which is not part of our pure substances. But why didn't D move? D did not move because the solvent that we have used, this substance is not soluble. That's why it has started to remain here, because this D is not soluble in the solvent that we have used. So in order to make this more effective, we need to find another solvent where D will be also soluble. Okay. So from this one, we can see that this one, which is C, it is the most soluble because it has moved the most distance. E, it is the least soluble because it has moved the least distance. So this is how we are able to check what a substance contains. So now we have seen what X contains. It contains A, C, D, and another unknown substance. So these pure substances are the ones that make up what X is. So we have identified what is found in X. And we have said chromatography is also important to identify amino acids. Now, how do you identify these amino acids? So to identify a substance, we just use what we call the RF values. These are called the retention values. So each substance has got its own RF value. So all the amino acids that got their own RF values. Okay, so we're going to use these ones to find which amino acid do we have. So how do you find this? So the retention value is found by, you get the ratio of the distance moved by a solute divided by the distance moved by the solvent flux. So we usually use this formula in order to identify the fine amino acid that is found there. Each amino acid has got its own RF value, which is the rotational value. So each substance is going to have its own, and we're going to know what substance it is by comparing these values. So in an example where we have done chromatography, and the chromatogram comes out like this. So we have got these two substances. We've got A, which is this one, and B, which is this one. So we want to identify what A is, and we want to know what B is. Remember we said this line can be called the baseline or the start line. Then we have got what we call the solvent front. After you put in a chromatogram tag, the solvent was moving. Where the solvent will end is what we call the solvent front. Now to find this value, the RF value, we said it is the ratio of the distance moved by the solute, which are these. We divide it by the distance moved by the solvent, which is this one. So you use a ruler here to measure the distance of the solvent from the start line up to this part, and the distance moved by the solute from this part up to the middle here, even this one, the same. Okay. So after you measure, so here we are using a meter rule to measure. You have got a ruler that you measure this distance from here up to here. They say that this distance is 5 centimeters. Then after measuring this distance here, we find that it's 4 centimeters. We say this one is 2, then this one is 4 centimeters. So we have measured this distance here to be 5. This one we have measured to be 4 from the start line up to the middle of this point. From the start line up to the middle of this point. So we have measured here from this line up to the middle, from this line up to the middle here. So this is 2 centimeters, 4 centimeters, and 5 centimeters. So after measuring these distances, now we can use our formula here. You can say, okay, the RF value for A is equal to the distance moved by A, which is 2 centimeters. We divide it by 5 centimeters. Then for B, the distance moved by B, which is 4, we divide it by 5 centimeters. So all the centimeters will go out because they will cancel out, meaning that the rotational value has got no unit. So even for B has got no unit because we have canceled out these ones. So now we divide the two. So this one will give us 0.4. So this is the rotational value for this one. Then this one will give us 0.8. So we have got these two. We have got the rotational value for this and the rotational value for this one. After you find these values, now you check on the table which will be given to compare what A is and what B is. So let me give an example. Let's say the 0.4 is equal to alanine, then the 0.8 is equal to glycine. Okay. So after you get this, you check now from the table, say, okay, the one for 0.4 is alanine. So meaning that A is the amino acid which is called alanine. Then for B, because the rotational value is 0.8, you check, oh, the one that has got 0.8 is glycine, meaning that B, this amino acid, is called glycine. So that's how we use the rotational value under chromatography to identify a substance. Okay, so we have looked at why chromatography is very, very important, and how can we use chromatography to identify the substances that are found in a mixer, like what you have done here. And now we can use chromatography to identify a substance. Like we have to know what A is, which amino acid is A, which amino acid is B, because all these, this is an amino acid, even this is the amino acid. We also said that a pure substance only moves once. In this case, A, B, C, D, and E, all these are pure substances because, for example, A has moved only once. It has one spot. But X is a mixer, has got more than one spot. B, a pure substance. C is a pure substance. D did not move, but E is a pure substance because it has moved once. So chromatography is very, very important because we use it to identify mixers or components of a mixer. We used to identify poisonous substances or poisonous drugs, and it also be used to separate substances. Okay, for today we'll end here.